subject for this evening is the source and summit of Christian life, the Eucharist. This is a teaching on the real presence of our Lord Jesus in the Eucharist, and this is the greatest gift of our Catholic faith. It is the heart of the Catholic faith. So it is important that we don't miss out on understanding what the Eucharist really is. Paragraph 1324 reads, the Eucharist is the source and summit of Christian life. The other sacraments, and indeed all ecclesiastical ministries and works of the apostolate, are bound up with the Eucharist and are oriented toward it. For in the Blessed Eucharist is contained the whole spiritual good of the church, namely Christ himself. So it is critical that we really appreciate the teaching of the church on the Eucharist. Why is it that whenever we have any celebration or any events in the church, it is always highlighted by the celebration of the Eucharist? So let us now try to understand, because it is a must that we truly appreciate what the Eucharist is. Let's understand what the Catholic Church teaches in this regard. Let's go to the next slide. Transubstantiation is the teaching of the church. Right off the bat, don't mistake it for transformation. It's not transformation, it's transubstantiation. Transformation is a change in form and appearance. For instance, a tree can be drastically transformed into pieces of furniture, okay? But that's not what transubstantiation is. Transubstantiation is not just a change of form. Transubstantiation is a change in substance. So paragraph 1374 clearly states that in the most blessed sacrament of the Eucharist, the body and blood, together with the soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ, and therefore the whole Christ, is truly, really, and substantially contained. This presence is called real, by which is not intended to exclude the other types of presence. What are the other types of presence? Well, you can say that God is everywhere. Jesus is everywhere. That is the attribute of divinity, omnipresent. But that's not what we're talking about. This is a different kind of presence, or spiritual presence. When you are with God, you have the Holy Spirit in you. You always have the Holy Spirit present in you. You call that spiritual presence. But this one is a different kind of presence. The presence is called real because it is presence in the fullest sense. This is to say, it is a substantial presence, the substance of Christ, by which Christ, God, and man makes himself holy and entirely present. In the Lateran Council of 1215, transubstantiation was also explained as follows. Because Christ, our Redeemer, said that it was truly his body that he was offering under the species of bread, it has always been the conviction of the Church of God. And this Holy Council, that's the Lateran Council, now declares again that by the consecration of the bread and wine, there takes place a change. Take note of that word, a change. A change of the whole substance of the bread into the substance of the body of Christ at consecration. It's not anymore bread. It is, in fact, the body of Christ. The whole substance of the wine is changed into the substance of his blood. It is no longer wine. It has become the blood of Christ. This change the Holy Church has fittingly and properly called transubstantiation. And Pope Paul VI explained in his Mysterium Fidei, number 46, he explains transubstantiation as follows. Christ is present, whole and entire, in his physical reality, corporeally present, although not in the manner in which bodies are present. So his presence, while it is truly his body and blood, is sacramental, but still corporeal, still physical, in that it is a material presence. Jesus humbly assumes the appearance of bread and wine just to be with us bodily, the most intimate way we can be with him. Our non-Catholic brothers and sisters always say, what matters more is our personal relationship with God. What can be a more intimate personal relationship with God than having him be consumed by us, his own flesh and blood? So our Lord Jesus Christ in his glorified body is present in two places. In his glorified body, he is there in heaven. And in his glorified body, he is in the Holy Eucharist. So his presence is sacramental, but it's always material in form. All outside appearances and sensible qualities, you call that the accidents of the bread and wine, remain. Christ has not become bread, but the bread has become Christ. This is a very difficult teaching. That's why we are going to expound on this to the most detail we can do. Let's go to the next slide. When does the moment of transubstantiation take place? Paragraph 1377. The Eucharistic presence of Christ begins at the moment of the consecration and endures as long as the Eucharistic species subsists. It lasts until the consecrated host is digested or dissolved, actually. Christ is present whole and entire in each of the species and whole and entire in each of their parts in such a way that the breaking of the bread does not divide Christ. And we worship the Eucharist. Let's go to the next slide. We just do not venerate the Eucharist. We adore the Eucharist. We worship the Eucharist. And we say that we are not idolaters in that sense, because we truly believe that this is Jesus Christ himself, body, blood, soul, and divinity. So paragraph 1378 of the Catechism reads, worship of the Eucharist in the liturgy of the Mass is expressing our faith in the real presence of Christ under the presence of bread and wine by, among others, genuflecting or bowing deeply as a sign of adoration of the Lord. Not just veneration, adoration. The Catholic Church has always offered and still offers to the sacrament of the Eucharist the cult of adoration, not only during Mass, but also outside of it, reserving the consecrated hosts with the utmost care, exposing them to the solemn veneration of the faithful, and carrying them in procession. So we have even this, we call perpetual adoration, where we expose the monstrance and we truly adore it when it is processed. We all kneel down before it because we truly worship. And what is alarming is that this, take note, because this is a very difficult concept. 7 out of 10 Catholics are confused in their beliefs about the Eucharist. Only 3 out of 10 understand that this is truly the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ. 70% have different beliefs about it. Most of them believe that it's just a symbol of the presence of Christ, which is not the case. It's not just a symbol. Some believe in consubstantiation. This is the teaching of the Lutheran Church. Consubstantiation meaning that Jesus Christ is present in the bread. So the bread is there and Jesus Christ is in the bread. That is consubstantiation. That is not transubstantiation, okay? So I think because of this, the fact that there are so many Catholics who are confused with the teaching on the Eucharist, we should find this subject a very essential subject in our faith formation. This is the heart of the Catholic faith. We cannot profess to be truly Catholic if we do not fully understand and appreciate transubstantiation. So this is what we are going to deal with tonight. Now, this belief has always been the belief of the church from the very beginning. From the very beginning of the church. This belief is an apostolic sacred tradition that has handed down to us all through the ages up to the present. So we are going to, I'm going to read to you the faith of the early fathers. Let's go to the next slide. This has always been the belief of the church. Faith of the early fathers. We have Saint Ignatius of Antioch. This is what he said, 110 AD, right? Contemporary of Apostle John. So he was living during the time of the apostles too. He wrote this, as early as then, I desire the bread of God, which is the flesh of Jesus Christ. And for drink, I desire his blood, which is love incorruptible. So from the time of the apostles, they have already professed that this is truly the flesh and blood of Jesus Christ. Then we go to Saint Justin Martyr, 150 AD. You see the continuity. Justin Martyr was being asked by the Emperor of Rome to explain why they should not be found to be guilty of cannibalism because of this teaching. And he explained in 150 AD to the Emperor, we call this food Eucharist and no one else is permitted to partake of it except the one who received this. That's what he said. For not as common bread or common drink do we receive this, but since Jesus Christ our Savior was made incarnate by the word of God and had both flesh and blood for our salvation, so too we have been taught. The food which has been made in the Eucharist by the Eucharistic prayer set down by him and by the chains which our blood and flesh is nourished is both the flesh and the blood of the incarnated Jesus. So he did not deny this before the emperor. And because of this, he was one of the martyrs of the church. And then down the line, we go to Saint Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyons, who is the pupil of Saint Polycarp, right there in that image there. And he was taught by John the Apostle. He wrote in 195 AD, he had declared the cup a part of creation to be his own blood, from which he causes our blood to flow, and the bread a part of creation he has established as his own body, in which he gives increase to our bodies. And then down the line, 350 AD, why am I painstakingly reading this? Because we want to emphasize the fact that this teaching has not been invented, but has rather been there from the very beginning. So Saint Cyril of Jerusalem in 350 AD wrote, "Do not therefore regard the bread and wine as simply that, for they are, according to the Master's declaration, the body and blood of Christ. Even though the senses suggest to you the other, let faith make you firm. Do not judge in this matter by taste, and be fully assured by the faith, not doubting that you have been deemed worthy of the body and blood of Christ." So down the line, until during the time of St. Thomas Aquinas, the greatest theologian of the church, he wrote in his Summa Theologia, he made a very thorough study of transubstantiation. And this is what he came up with. And I quote, "The presence of Christ." This is Thomas Aquinas. Right? "The presence of Christ through body and blood in this sacrament cannot be detected by sense nor understanding, but by faith alone, which rests upon divine authority." So you see, even St. Thomas Aquinas had a very difficult time trying to understand how transubstantiation can be truly what is happening in the Eucharist. And that was his conclusion, the greatest theologian of all time. "This is to be taken by faith. That has always been the teaching of Jesus Christ himself." So therefore, let's go to the teaching of Jesus Christ himself. Next slide. What is the teaching of Jesus Christ about the Eucharist? This is contained in John 6. That's why I advise you to please read the whole chapter of John 6, because this is really a discourse on the Eucharist. The setting here in one of the synagogues in Capernaum, the Jews were asking Jesus what sign he could perform so that they may believe in him. And they said, "You know, our ancestors fed us with manna from heaven. Can you beat that?" They told Jesus. And Jesus answered, I'm paraphrasing though, "Of course. Moses God the Father has sent you manna from heaven, but I am the manna that came down from heaven. I am the bread of life. The manna that Moses made possible to you was eaten and drunk, and yet still they got hungry and they got thirsty. But the manna from heaven that I am, if you take me, you will never hunger and you will never thirst." And then in verse 51, he explained what he meant by the bread of life. "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And here you go. The bread that I will give is my flesh. My flesh for the life of the world." So if you read on in verse 52, the people that were listening to him, the disciples, were dumbfounded. They understood him to be speaking literally. And they were wondering, what is this kind of teaching? How can this man give his flesh to eat? And so Jesus continued with his teaching on the Eucharist. Next slide. In John chapter 6, now, firstly, you should understand that you really need a unique and special faith needed to accept this very difficult teaching, because it is already difficult to believe that Jesus is God, that he is divine, because he is in the human flesh. But it is even more difficult to believe that the Eucharist is the body and blood of Christ, because the Eucharist veils both his humanity, and his divinity. But come to think of it, why would this really be a problem to us? Aren't we surrounded by a lot of mysteries in our life? Is it not a fact? Do we not believe that God created heavens and the earth out of nothing? That he transforms the tiny blade into nutritious grain? That he rained down manna from heaven for 40 years? He changed rivers into the blood, into blood in Egypt. He did that. He changed water into wine at Cana. It's not that everything around us mystery? Are we not a mystery to ourselves? Is that the scripture full of incomprehensible mysteries? So why are we having a problem understanding this? This is a mystery. So Jesus Christ explained this fully in his discourse. Next slide. John chapter 6, verses 53 to 58. He made it clear that he was speaking literally, not symbolically. We'll go at it one by one in all these scriptural passages in the image that you see there. We'll start with John chapter 6, verses 53 to 58. Let's read it together. Next slide. John chapter 6, 53 to 58. So after the disciples were asking, how can this man give his flesh? This is how Jesus replied. Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man. Take note, eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood. You have no life in you. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drink my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Then he said, for my flesh is meat. Very literal. My flesh is meat indeed. And my blood is drink indeed. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood dwelleth in me, and I in him. As the living Father has sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eats me, even he shall live by me. The Greek word for the word eat here is trogon, which means chew. He who chews me, to chew the food, he shall live by me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers did eat manna and are dead. He that eateth of this bread shall live forever. So look here, the disciples were wondering, how can this man give his flesh to eat? Did he say, you're taking me literally. I mean, there is a symbol in what I said. He did not say that. This is what he said. Indeed, indeed. Yes, amen, amen. You got it precisely. I'm talking about a literal flesh of mine and a literal blood of mine. So in John chapter 6, verses 60, the disciples were having a hard time really accepting this teaching of Jesus. They left him. Let's go to John chapter 6, verse 60. Next slide. They left him. They could not accept it. Many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard teaching. A hard saying. Who can understand it? They were already complaining back then. And we are still complaining up to now. 7 out of 10 Catholics are complaining. This is a hard saying. Who can understand it? And then when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? And then they started leaving him. And only the apostles were left behind. In John chapter 6, verses 66 to 68, Jesus even challenged the apostles who were left. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed Jesus. And then he turned to the apostles who were left and he said, you do not want to live too? You can live too, do you? Jesus asked the crowd, don't you want to live too? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. So in this discourse, it is so clear that Jesus was speaking literally. And his disciples who understood him to be speaking literally could not take any of it and they left. Jesus did not call them back. Jesus did not say, come back here. I don't mean to teach you this thing literally. I mean, this is something symbolic. Let me explain it to you. No, he did not. He said, indeed, I'm telling you. This is truly my flesh and my blood. This is what I am asking you to eat, to chew. So they left him and the apostles were the ones left. That's why St. Paul was very careful in giving a warning in regard to people who do not understand the Eucharist. Let's go to the next slide in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 27 to 29. Paul said, therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself. This is a very stern warning given by Paul to emphasize the necessity of us appreciating fully that this is not just a symbol of the body and blood of Christ, and that this is actually his own body and blood. Let's go to the next slide. Jesus said, eating, you have to eat and drink. You know, Jesus could not have been figuratively speaking because the expression eating bread and drinking blood in Hebrew means to persecute, to assault, and destroy. Did he want his disciples to assault and destroy him for them to have eternal life? So if you check it out in Psalms 27, verse 2, Isaiah 49, 26, Micah, 2 Samuel, and Revelation, go through all of this. The use of the word eating bread and drinking blood, devouring the flesh, eating the flesh of my people means assaulting, means destroying. Okay. So that was the meaning of eating bread and drinking blood in Hebrew. Jesus never meant, of course, to teach that you should assault and destroy him for them to be able to have eternal life. You know, whenever Jesus spoke symbolically, there are times when he spoke symbolically, he would right away explain that he was speaking figuratively, especially when his disciples understood him to be speaking literally. Let's go to the next slide. In John chapter 4, verse 31 to 34, these are instances when Jesus explained that he was only speaking symbolically and not literally. John chapter 4, verse 31 to 34, Jesus says, I have food to eat of which you do not know. His disciples took him literally. Now, here Jesus explained, my food is to do the will of the one who sent me. So he explained that. So you don't take it literally. What I'm talking about is the doing the will of my Father. Okay. Then in Matthew chapter 16, verse 12, Jesus says, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Once again, the disciples think Jesus is speaking literally. Again, Jesus corrects them and explains that he's not talking about real bread. Now, so they understood that he was not telling them to be aware of the bread itself, but of the what? Of the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. So he explained in John chapter 3, verse 3 to 5, we took this up. Nicodemus was asking Jesus, what do you mean born again? You mean you have to re-enter the, you have to re-enter the womb of your mother and then be born again? So he took it literally. And Jesus explained, no, unless you are born of water and the Spirit. He was speaking about baptism. We took that up the other time. Matthew chapter 19, verse 24 to 26. Jesus said, it is easier for the camel to enter the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. My God, if you take that literally, it's impossible. No, it's only emphasizing the difficulty, that stresses the impossibility of entering heaven without the help of God. You need God's help. And then in John chapter 8, verse 36, Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And now the Jews who heard him were complaining. What do you mean the truth will set us free? We are already free. We have been emancipated from our slavery in Egypt. And Jesus explained, but you are still slaves of sins. If you know the truth, you will be freed from the slavery of sin. So in all of these instances, you see that Jesus was taking pain to explain what he meant whenever he speaks in a figurative way. All right, so let's go to the next slide. Let's try to understand the mindset. Next slide. The mindset of our non-Catholic brothers and sisters. They are arguing about this because even up to now, all non-Catholic Christians do not believe in transubstantiation. All of them believe that this is just a symbol, except the Lutheran, which believes in consubstantiation. I've explained to you what that is. Especially the fundamentalists, they would never take this. But the irony of it is that the fundamentalists are literalists in their approach of scriptures. Yet, when it comes to John 6, when Jesus himself made clear that he was speaking literally, all of a sudden, the fundamentalists flip-flop and insist that it is just a symbol. So let's address their objections one by one. All right? Let's with the next slide. First objection is they try to quote under John chapter 6, verse 35. They say that it means coming to him and to drink means believing in him. Because in John chapter 6, verse 35, Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. So this is what they point out. So you see, what Jesus means is that he is the bread of life. Coming to him is bread, and drinking him is having faith in him. But take note, this is verse 35 of John 6. Jesus had the occasion to explain this after John chapter 6, verse 35. He explained this fully and very clearly in John, subsequent to John chapter 6, verse 35, John chapter 6, verse 53 to 68. We just read that to you. So he very clearly states that he is not talking about coming to him, will be eating him, and that believing in him will be drinking him. He did not. He said what is eating him and what is drinking him in verses 53 to 68. So clearly, he's not saying that, you know, what I mean is that what I have just said is symbolic. Let's go to the next slide. John chapter 6, verse 63. Next slide. They also point this out. John chapter 6, verse 63. In fact, when I was having my stint with with the Protestant churches, whenever we have this Eucharistic celebration, we would, the pastor would, we have our own communion, and the pastor would raise up the bread and say, "This represents my body." And I was wondering, why did he say represent when the scripture very clearly states, "This is my body"? Not he, Jesus did not say, "This represents my body." And during our communion services, every pastor that does that and raises the bread would say, "This represents my body," because they're trying to incorporate their belief into what they're doing. And when I asked the pastor about this, I said, "Why did you misquote the scripture?" Well, he said he was only speaking literally. Look at John chapter 6, verse 63. "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit and are life." And he said, "See, it is only symbolic." "What?" I said, but I thought, I did not quite understand it. And I said, "Maybe yes, maybe." I sort of took that as a good explanation, but it is not. When you said it is the Spirit who gives life, it does not mean that what I have said is just symbolic, because the Spirit is real. The Spirit is not symbolic. The angels are spirit. The Holy Spirit is real. It's not saying you eat of me and it's a waste of time. It's of no avail. The flesh, does it mean to say that eating his real flesh is a waste? It has no use that he was speaking about? Then he explained that actually he was speaking about the flesh, not my flesh. In John chapter 6, verse 63, the discourse was about faith. He was talking about the flesh, the natural man. And that is fully explained in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 to 15. The spiritual man. The natural man receives not the things of the Spirit of God. They will not understand it, for they are foolishness unto him, and he cannot know them, because they are spiritually judged. But he that is spiritual judges all things, and he himself is judge of no man. So here in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 to 15, he made it very clear that what it really means is that only by the power of the Holy Spirit can you understand this teaching, contrasting the natural man, the flesh, not my flesh, the flesh, contrasting the flesh with the spirit, with the spiritual or faith-filled man. Okay? Okay, so let's go to the other objections that our non-Catholic brothers and sisters always raise. Next slide. Next slide, please. The Eucharist is just a metaphor, according to them, because there are scriptural passages where Jesus spoke metaphorically or figuratively. For instance, John chapter 15, verse 1 and 2. He said, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches." That's a great metaphor. That is very easy to understand, that you need to be attached to the Lord. That is what it meant. So it is a metaphor. When he said, "I am the vine, you are the branches," he did not mean it literally. Another one, in John chapter verse 9, he said, "I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture." He did not mean that literally. He meant that metaphorically. And it is a very natural metaphor. But what about "I am the bread"? Can you make out any metaphor out of that? Is that a natural metaphor? Unless you explain what you mean by that, it cannot be understood as a metaphor. I am the God I am the bread and I am the blood. I am the flesh. See? That cannot be a metaphorical statement of Jesus. So that objection again must fail. Other objections from our non-Catholic brothers and sisters. Next slide. Next slide, Brother Tito. The other objections. The Catholic belief in the Eucharist is cannibalism. Oh, that's a common objection. But we must understand that we are not receiving the Eucharist in the natural flesh of Jesus while he was here on earth. It is in the glorified body and blood of Jesus. We are receiving divine bread and divine wine. It is to be received sacramentally under the appearance of bread and wine. Jesus is hidden in this way. You know, cannibalism means eating of the same kind or the same species, but this one is a different species. We're talking about divine flesh, divine blood. Okay? Or another objection, it is impossible for Jesus' flesh and blood to be in one place, in two places at the same time, or in different places. So you mean to say when Jesus, during the Last Supper, was raising up that bread and started distributing the bread, he was present right there, and at the same time, he was present on the 12th man that was sitting at the end of the table holding that bread? He is multi-locating. So what's the problem with that? Many saints are multi-locating. Is there anything impossible with God? Padre Pio, for instance. Padre Pio is a saint that is known to be multi-locating. You know, there is this one incident when a certain Ellie Hunt, who was always, who used to deliver egg to Father Pio in Petrosina, Italy. Ellie Hunt migrated to New York. And then he lived there for quite a while until his grandfather in New York became ill. And you know what? Father Pio was in Italy. Petrosina, Italy. And Padre Pio appeared at the deathbed of the father and gave the last anointing to his grandfather. He multi-located. Padre Pio is known for multi-location. So it's not, if it is possible for Padre Pio, why would it be possible for Jesus to multi-locate? And then another objection. The Levitical law prohibits drinking blood. Oh, that's the Levitical law. I think we have already explained this. The Levitical law has passed away under the new priesthood of our Lord Jesus Christ. For instance, the teaching in the Levitical law about divorce, he said Moses allowed you to divorce because of your hardness of the heart, but from the very beginning, it was never so. So explain it. The Sabbath is part of the Levitical law. It has passed away with the new priesthood. And the other aspects of Moses' law have passed away. So we don't, that's our Sabbath now is the Lord's day. Okay? Another objection. Even after consecration, Jesus calls the content of the cup fruit of the vine. This is the fruit of the vine, he said. And St. Paul, in his discourse, also continues to call the element bread. So they still call it bread. They call it wine. Well, the scriptures always often call things by their appearance. It's natural. The angels that appeared to Abraham, they were angels, but they were referred to in the account of Abraham as men. The wine of Cana, after it has been changed into wine, it's still referred to in scripture as water. So all of these objections of our non-Catholic brothers and sisters can be addressed and can be explained. And we hope that we would be able to explain to them all these objections, all right? So this is the reason why we cannot have Eucharistic intercommunion with our non-Catholic brothers and sisters. Next slide. Let's read from the Catechism. Next slide. Ecclesial communities derived from the Reformation and separated from the Catholic Church have not preserved the proper reality of the Eucharistic mystery in its fullness, especially because of the absence of the sacrament of Holy Orders. So there is no Eucharist in the non-Catholic denominations of the Christian Church. It is for this reason that for the Catholic Church, Eucharistic intercommunion with these communities is not possible. This is the reason why when there are non-Catholic attending the Mass and during communion, the priest would always advise those of you who are non-Catholics, please just fold your hands on your breast and you will just get a blessing instead of receiving the Eucharist, right? Because we cannot have intercommunion with them, for they do not, and they do not believe that it is truly the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. So you can see here from the very start, it has always been the belief of the church. It has always been the consistent teaching of the church, because Jesus himself taught this to be literally his body and blood. Jesus himself taught this to be transubstantiated, change in the substance. And there are physical proofs of this incident. We have what you call the Eucharistic miracles. Next slide. An example, there are many of them. This is just one of the examples. The Eucharistic miracle in Lanciano, Italy. This happened in the 18th century. You know, this is what I'm going to read to you at the back. In the 8th century, a priest, after pronouncing the words of consecration, had a strong temptation to doubt the real presence of Jesus. Before the startled priest's eyes, the sacred pose visibly changed into a circle of flesh right there. It's still preserved up to now. The consecrated wine was transformed into bright red blood, coagulating into 5 small clots, different in form and size. 4 authentications have been performed throughout the centuries. This happened in 8th century, but it happened until 1970. There have been many examinations, medical examinations of this flesh and blood of Jesus. The last verification was ordered by the Pope himself in 1970. This is the most scientifically complete verification. Microscopic studies document the following. The flesh is real human flesh, and the blood is real human blood. The flesh is composed of cardiac muscular tissue, having no trace whatsoever of any materials or agents used for preservation of the flesh. No preservative was ever used. Both the flesh and the blood belong to the same blood type, type AB. The proteins in the blood are in the same proportion as those found in normal fresh blood. This ongoing miracle is visible even today, after more than 1,200 years of existence. Some of you probably have visited Lanciano, Italy, and must have seen this yourself, exposed in the tabernacle. The host flesh appears rose-colored when black-lighted. The color of the 5 clots of coagulated blood is a brownish-red hue, tending towards yellow. Here's another Eucharistic miracle. The holy miracle at Santarém. Some historians say it happened in 1247. Others say it happened in 1266. At that time, there lived in the village of Santarém, today a city of Portugal, a poor woman whose life was made miserable by her unfaithful husband. Weary of so much unhappiness, she decided to consult a Jewish sorceress for aid. The sorceress promised the woman that all her difficulties would disappear if she would bring her a consecrated host. After great hesitation, the poor woman decided to commit this sacrilege. After being heard in confession of the church at Santo Estevão, she proceeded to the altar and, after receiving the blessed sacrament, removed it from her mouth and carefully wrapped it in a veil. She then proceeded to leave the church and hurry to the sorceress' cave, not noticing great drops of blood falling from her veil. Others who saw the blood inquired why she was bleeding so profusely. Confused and perplexed, she ran home and hid the Holy Sacrament in one of the wooden chests. Late that day, her husband returned. In the middle of the night, they awoke and saw that the house was lit up by the mysterious rays of light which penetrated through the chest. The woman confessed her sin to her husband, and both of them spent the rest of the night upon their knees in adoration. At daybreak, the parish priest was informed, and people from far and near rushed to the woman's house to contemplate the holy miracle. The Blessed Sacrament was then taken in procession to the church of St. Stephen, where it was placed in a small case of wax. Sometime later, when the tabernacle was opened for adoration of the Blessed Sacrament, another miracle took place. The wax case was found broken in pieces and the Holy Sacrament encased in a beautiful crystal pyx. The pyx was placed in a gold-plated silver monstrance and can be seen up to this day. You can go to Santarém in Portugal and you can see this. This is the one. And one more miracle. So you see, Jesus, God is so set in letting us understand the Eucharist. He has been doing all these Eucharistic miracles. Let's go to the next slide. You must have heard. Next slide, please. Brother Tito. Oh my. Therese Newman. Look at her in her picture there. This woman, and let me read this to you. She was not eating at all, anything. Let me read to you the account. Therese Newman, who lived the last 36 years of her life without any food or water, but only Holy Communion. Receiving Holy Communion gave her a surge of energy. She required no sleep. The host would sustain her for almost one full day. At the end of the 24-hour period, she could feel her life ebbing, but would regain her strength as soon as she received Holy Communion. Doctors and scientists who examined her concluded that the only thing keeping her alive was Holy Communion. Many other people have lived on nothing but the Eucharist. Saint Catherine of Siena, Saint Joseph of Cupertino, Saint Rose of Lima. These are just some of the better known saints who have lived in the Holy Communion alone. So, brothers and sisters, we must truly understand the greatest gift that God has given us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son so that we can really encounter him in the flesh, so that we can really have a corporeal encounter, that the greatest sacramental encounter we can have with Jesus, the Eucharist. So we hope that when we take the Eucharist, we keep this all in mind and really adore Jesus when we receive Holy Communion in our heart. So that brings us to the end of our discussion this evening. Thank you. Now we will break up. Next slide.